First, we'll understand the concept of God in Hinduism. If you ask a common Hindu that how many gods does he believe in, some will say 3, some will say 100, some will say 1,000, while the others will say 33 crores, 330 million. But if you ask a learned Hindu who is well versed with his Hindu scriptures, he will tell you that the Hindus should believe and worship only one God. But the common Hindu, he believes in a philosophy known as pantheism. The common Hindu believes that everything is God. The sun is God, the moon is God, the tree is God, the human being is God, the snake is God. What we Muslims believe is everything is God's. G-O-D with an apostrophe, yes. Everything belongs to God. The sun belongs to God, the moon belongs to God, the tree belongs to God, the human being belongs to God, the snake belongs to God. So the major difference between the Hindus and the Muslims is the common Hindu believes that everything is God. We Muslims believe everything is God's. G-O-D with an apostrophe, yes. The major difference is the apostrophe, yes. If you can solve this difference of apostrophe, yes, the Hindus and the Muslims will be united. How do you do it? تَعَلَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَ بَيْنَكُمْ. Come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. That we worship none but one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us try and understand what is the concept of God in Hinduism by trying to understand what the Hindu scriptures have to speak about Almighty God. Among the sacred scriptures of the Hindus, one of the sacred scriptures is known as Upanishads. It's mentioned in the Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1. It says, Ikkam Evidityam, God is only one without a second. It's mentioned in the Shweta Setara Upanishad, chapter number 6, verse number 9. Na chasya kasij janita na chadipa. Of that God, he has got no parents. He has got no superior. Almighty God has got no mother. He has got no father. He has got no Lord. It's mentioned in the Shweta Sitara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. Pratima is a Sanskrit word which means an image. It means a photograph. It means a picture. It means a painting. It means a statue. It means an idol. It means a sculpture. So it's mentioned in Shweta Sahasrara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. There is no image. There is no photograph. There is no painting. There is no picture. There is no idol. There is no sculpture. There is no painting. Who says that? Shweta Sahasrara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. Further, if you read amongst the Hindu scriptures, the most sacred are the Vedas. It's mentioned in Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. Pratima, as I mentioned earlier, means an image, a photograph, a picture, a painting, a sculpture, a statue, an idol. It's mentioned in Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. There is no image. There is no picture. There is no painting. There is no photograph. There is no idol. There is no sculpture. There is no statue. Further, it's mentioned in the Yajurved, chapter number 40, verse number 8. Almighty God is imageless and pure. It's mentioned in Yajurved, chapter number 40, verse number 9. Andhatma pravishanti ya asambhuti mupaste. Andhatma means darkness. Pravishanti means entering. Asambhuti means things which are natural, like fire, water, air. It's mentioned in Yajurved, chapter 40, verse number 9. Andhatma pravishanti ya asambhuti mupaste. They are entering darkness, those who worship the asambhuti, the fire, the water, the air. And the verse continues. They are entering more in darkness, those who worship the sambhuti, that's the created thing, like table, chair, idols, etc. Who says that? Yajurved, chapter 40, verse number 9. Among the Hindu scripture, the most popular amongst all the Hindu scripture is the Bhagavad Gita. It's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 7, verse number 20. All those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, they worship demigods, they worship false gods. It further mentioned Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 58, verse number 3. Dev Maha Asi, verily great is Almighty God. And amongst the Vedas, the most sacred is the Rig Ved. It's mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 164, mantra number 46. Ikkam sat viprabhauda vidante. Truth is one, God is one, and saints call him by a variety of names. And there are no less than 33 different attributes given to Almighty God in Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1 alone. One amongst these attributes mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, is Brahma. Brahma is called as the creator God. If you translate creator into Arabic, it becomes Khalik. We Muslims have got no objection if someone calls Almighty God as Khalik or creator or Brahma. But if someone says Brahma is Almighty God who has got forehead on and on each head is a crown, we Muslims take strong objection to it. Because you are going against Svetasetara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, which says Natasya Patima Asti, of that God there is no image. Another attribute given to Almighty God in Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, is Vishnu. Vishnu is called as the sustainer God. Sustainer, if you translate into Arabic, it means Rab. We Muslims have got no objection if someone calls Almighty God as Rab or sustainer or Vishnu. But if you say Vishnu is Almighty God, has got four hands, one of his right hand is the discus, the other left hand, he has a conch, he's traveling on the water on the bed of snake or flying on the bird by the name of Garuda, we Muslims take strong exception to it. Moreover, you're going against Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3, which says, Na tasya patima asti, of that God there is no image. It further mentioned in Rigved, book number 8, hymn number 1, verse number 1, Machidanidhi Sansad, worship only one God, praise him alone. It's mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 6, hymn number 46, verse number 16. Ya ekit mushtihi, there is only one God, worship him alone, praise him alone. And the Brahma Sutra of Hinduism is, Ekam Brahm Dyutya Naste, Nena Naste Kinchan, Bhagwan Eki hai, Dusra Nahi hai, Nahi hai, Nahi hai, Zara bhi Nahi hai. There's only one God, not a second one, not at all, not at all, not in the least bit. So if you read the Hindu scriptures, you shall understand the concept of God in Hinduism and understand Hinduism in the correct perspective. Let us understand the concept of God in Islam. The best reply that any Muslim can give you regarding the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the glorious Quran is quoted to you Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4, which says, Kul huwa Allahu ahad, say He is Allah one and only. Allahu Samad, Allah the absolute and eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad, He begets not nor is begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, there's nothing like Him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given in the glorious Quran. If any person says that so and so candidate is God, if that candidate fits in this four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that person as God. The first is Kul wallahu ahad, say He's Allah one and only. Second, Allahu Samad, Allah the absolute and eternal. Third, Lam yalid walam yulad, He begets not nor is begotten. And the fourth, Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, there's nothing like Him. This Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. Theo means God, logy means study, theology means study of God. Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. You know what's the touchstone? If you want to sell or buy any jewelry, gold jewelry, what do? You go to a goldsmith and check how pure is the gold. He takes the gold jewelry and rubs it against a touchstone. And depending upon the color, he says whether it's 24 karat gold, whether it's 22 karat gold, whether it's 18 karat gold, or he may say it is not gold at all, because all that glitters is not gold. Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. Whichever God you worship, put him to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If that God passes the test, it's a true God. Otherwise, it's not a true God. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, there's nothing like Him. We Muslims, we prefer calling God by the Arabic word Allah. Why? Though Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 110. Kulidullah abidur Rahman, ayyamata du falal asmal husna. Say, call upon Him by Allah or by Rahman, by whichever name you call upon Him, to Him belongs the most beautiful name. And there are no less than 99 different attributes given to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the glorious Quran. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Hakim, most merciful, most gracious, most wise. And the crowning one is Allah. Why do we Muslims prefer calling Allah by the Arabic word Allah instead of the English word God? Because the Arabic word Allah is pure. All the other words, you can play mischief with it. For example, the English word God, you can play mischief with it. If you add S to God, it becomes gods. There's nothing like plural Allah. Kul huwallahu ahad. Says Allah one and only. If you add D-E-S-S to God, it becomes a female God. There's nothing like male Allah or female Allah in Islam. If you add a father to God, it becomes Godfather. He's my Godfather, he's my guardian. There's no Allah, Father, or Allah by in Islam. If you add mother to God, it becomes Godmother. There's nothing like Allah Ammi or Allah Mother in Islam. Allah is a pure word. That's the reason we Muslims, we prefer calling Allah by the Arabic word Allah instead of the English word God. But when you're speaking to non-Muslims who may not understand the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if you use the English translation God, which is not correct, I've got no objection. But I'd like to remind you that God is not the appropriate translation of the Arabic word Allah. Islam is deen. Islam is a way of life. It caters both to the physical needs of the body and the spiritual needs of the soul. Islam comes from the root word salam, which means peace. It's also derived from the Arabic word silm, which means to submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam in short means peace acquired by submitting your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Good evening, Dr. Zakir. My name is Jal and I work here for Emirates Bank International. My question to you is, which other religion says that they are awaiting the coming of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, other than Muslim and Christianity?
Sisters asked the question that which other religion besides Islam and Christianity says that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will come. Sister, besides the religion of Christianity and Islam, most, if not all, most of the religions that came before Islam prophesied about coming of the last and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I've given a talk on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the various world religious scriptures. Besides Christianity, you also find in Judaism about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 18 about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 19. In the book of Isaiah, chapter number 29, verse number 12. In the Song of Solomon, chapter number 5, verse number 16. That's the Old Testament. In the New Testament, Christianity is mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 16. Gospel of John, chapter 15, verse 26. Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse number 7. Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14. There are many verses in the Old Testament and the New Testament prophesying about the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Since your name is Jal, and I assume you're a Hindu sister, correct?
Yes.
I've even given a talk on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Hindu scriptures. I can give a talk for a few hours only on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam Hindu scriptures. Time will not permit me to go into it. I'll just give the references. If you read the Hindu scriptures are of two types. One is Smriti, the other is Shruti. Shruti means the word of God, in which we have Vedas and the Upanishad. Smriti is the word of human being, in which you have Manusmriti, you have Ramayana, Mahabharata, epics, etc. You also have the Puranas. If you read Bhavishya Purana, it's mentioned Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, which speaks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's mentioned Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 10 to 27, talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the Malecha. He is mentioned in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 6. Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 7. He is also mentioned in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, verse 1 to 14, which is called as Kuntap Suktas. Kuntap means hiding. It speaks about the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he will be the praiseworthy, he will have 60,000 enemies, etc. He is also mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 1, chapter number 53, verse number 9. He is mentioned as Ahmad, which means one who praises, in Uttarchik, mantra number 1500. It's mentioned in Indra, chapter number 2, verse number 152. Yajurved, chapter number 31, verse number 18. He is also mentioned in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 126, verse number 1 to 14. He is called as Narashansa. Nar means man, person. Shansa means coming from Prashansa, praiseworthy. A man who's praiseworthy. If you translate Narashansa, man who's praiseworthy, into Arabic, it means Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's prophesied as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 13, verse number 3. In Rig Ved, book number 10, hymn number 64, verse number 3. He's mentioned Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 3, verse number 5. Rig Ved, book number 5, hymn number 5, verse number 2. He's also mentioned Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse 37. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 31. I can go on and on and on, mentioning only the references of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in Hindu scriptures. Due to limitation of time, I will just touch on one prophecy a little bit in more detail. He's been prophesied as the Kalki Avatar. You know, when you read the Kalki Purana, book number 2, verse number 5, 7, 9, 11, 14, he's prophesied as the Kalki Avatar. And it's mentioned there that his father's name will be Vishnu Yas. Vishnu means God, Yas means servant, servant of God. If you translate to Arabic, it's Abdullah. The father of the name of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Abdullah. His mother's name will be Sumati. Sumati means serenity, peaceful. If you translate Arabic, it means Amina. The name of the mother of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Amina. It says he will be born in a city by the name Sambala. Sambala means a place of peace and serenity. That is Makkah. He'll be born in the house of the chief of the village of Sambala. He was born in the house of Quraysh. It says he will be born on the 12th. You clap at every point, it will go on for hundreds of claps, mashallah. He'll be born on the 12th month of Madhav, that the 12th Rabbi Awal. It says that he will be a teacher for the whole of humanity. And we know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent at the mercy of the whole of humanity. It says he'll get the first revelation in a cave known as Gare Hira. It says he will migrate northwards and come back. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went from Makkah to Medina northwards and came back. It says that he'll be given 8 supernal qualities. It says that he'll have 4 companions, talking about the first 4 Khulafa Rashideen. It says that he'll be helped with the angels in the battlefield. We know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam held in the battle of Badr with angels. I can go on and on talking only about the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you're a Hindu, and if you believe in the Hindu scriptures, you also have to believe the last and final avatar, the last and final messenger in Hinduism is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
However, Doctor, according to Hinduism, the Kalki avatar is still being awaited. So are you, just not aware about it?
You said the Kalki avatar is yet awaited. If you have not recognized the Kalki avatar, you are to blame, not me. I have given you so many similarities. Now you have to disprove it. You say, my scripture says Vishnu Yas, father's name. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, father's name was not Vishnu Yas. You have to disprove me. Now this has been done by pundits of Hinduism. Hindu scholars have also written this. Now the Hindu scholars are preventing the truth from you. They are hiding the truth from you. You as a logical girl, as intelligent girl who is working in a high post, it's your duty to realize that if your priest are hiding the truth from you, we can have a debate with your priest. You can call the doctors of divinity. You know, I have had dialogues with pandits. You know, one of the very famous is Shri Ravi Shankar. He never disagreed. He agreed. He agreed with what I said about oneness of Almighty God, has got no images. He believed in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not accept that's a different thing because he will lose his following. Therefore, sister, do you have a following? So you have no fear to lose the following. So when I've given you so many references with giving quotations, I'm not pulling a fast one. You can very well go and check and verify. But after you verify, do you accept in the last and final messenger? Do you?
Yes.
So do you believe in Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? MashaAllah. Do you believe that there's one God?
Yes, I do.
Do you believe Almighty God has got no images?
Yes, I do.
So you believe there's God and he has no images?
Yes.
And do you believe Prophet Muhammad is a messenger of God?
Yes, I do.
Then you're a Muslim, sister. What you said is the Shahada in English, Do you want to repeat in Arabic if you want, sister? What you said is in English, that there's no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger. Would you like to repeat in Arabic, sister?
I do.
Okay, I'll just repeat it and you have to continue, sister. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Ablu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
MashaAllah, sister. May Allah. MashaAllah, sister. May Allah reward you. You have joined a family of religion of peace of more than 1.3 to 1.5 billion. May Allah reward you. And may Allah grant you Jannah, inshallah. And believe me, sister, it requires guts. I feel that, mashallah, I really admire your guts more than Shri Shri Ravi Shankar, mashallah. And I pray that may give you hidayah and may he guide you, inshallah. And sister, if you have any questions, any queries, there are local organizations in Dubai who can surely clarify your misconceptions. To understand Islam, look at the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. They are the best guides. If you have any queries, you can even write to the email at islam@irf.net. It's my pleasure to reply. And do pray for me also, sister.
Sir, I'm Dr. Rajesh. I am a homeopathic doctor. And I have two questions that I have read that about Muhammad Peygamber as the last and the final prophet. Why the stress is given on the word last and the final? And are you afraid of any new one? And if God decides and will send a new one, don't you welcome him? And agar main upar wale ka didar karna chahta hoon, to Islam uska kya solution hai? Thank you, sir.
Brother, there are two questions. One thing, that why do you stress so much that he's the last prophet? If God wants to send a second one, can't he send? And the last question is, if I want to see Almighty God, what is the solution? I'll come to the last question later on. The first question, why do I stress that Prophet Muhammad is the last prophet? Not only I stress, the Veda stress, the Purana stress, the Bible stress, as well as the Quran and the other scriptures. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Azab, chapter number 33, verse number 40. Ma kana Muhammadun aba ahadim min rijalikum walakin rasulullah wa khatamun nabiyyin wa kana Allahu bi kulli shay'in alima. That Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is not the father of any of you men, but he is the prophet of Almighty God. He is the seal of the prophets. And Allah is all-knowing, full of knowledge. Now when Almighty God said, if Almighty God wants to send, he can surely send. But Almighty God does not speak a lie. Almighty God doesn't tell a lie. It's mentioned in the Quran in chapter 33, Surah Azab, chapter 33, verse 40, that this is the last prophet. So Almighty God knows. If he wanted to send another prophet, he would not have mentioned this is the last prophet. So because he had mentioned it as the last prophet, I believe in it. And since Almighty God, he knows the future. You and I don't know the future. Almighty God knows the future, and he said that this is the last. Therefore, I believe in it. Now, depending upon the requirement, what was required, he has given. Some people say, why didn't he send Prophet Muhammad in the day one? You know, my son wants to do medicine. He said, why don't you put me in medical college directly? First, you have to go to school. Standard one, standard two, standard three, pass school, then medical, right? So depending upon how the humanity progressed, Almighty God kept on sending messengers. And by name, four are mentioned, but there were many revelations sent. Torah, Zabur, Injil by name is mentioned. Now, Almighty God thought it fit that 1400 years back, humanity reached a level to understand the Quran. Then he sent his last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Last and final message, the glorious Quran. Now, if Almighty God wants, he can surely send. But since he has mentioned, he will not send, he will not send. And this religion has completed. The previous scriptures were not in the complete form. Allah mentions, Almighty God mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse number 3,
that on this day have I completed my favor unto you, have chosen for you Islam and complete the religion for you. After the religion of Islam is completed, nothing new can be added, nothing can be subtracted from this religion. It's complete. That's the reason if anyone today says that he gets revelation from Almighty God, anyone who says he's a prophet of God, he has to go to a psychiatrist. Today, there are hundreds of people claiming to be God, people claiming to be prophets of God. They require a psychiatrist. Because after this, no other revelation will come. After this, no other prophet will come.
Alhamdulillah, two brothers from Nigeria, they want to give the Shahada. I would like to ask them that, do you believe that there's one God?
Yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
And I'll just say it in Arabic and you can repeat it inshallah. Ashadu.
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 Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
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 Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammad.
Abduhu.
Abdul.
Wa rusuluhu.
Wa rusuluhu.
I bear witness. I bear witness.
I bear witness.
That there is no God but Allah.
There is no God but Allah.
And Prophet Muhammad.
And Prophet Muhammad
is the servant
and the summit
and messenger of Allah.
And messenger of Allah.
MashaAllah, Allah Muslim, MashaAllah. Mabruk. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that inshallah He grants you Jannah. Takbir. 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 The brother from Russia, his name is Mikhail. And he wants to accept Islam. Correct. Do you believe there's one God?
Yes.
Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
MashaAllah. So I'll just say in Arabic and you can repeat inshallah. Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam? Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam? They're doing out of your own free will. MashaAllah. Brother, they're doing out of their own free will. I say in Arabic and you can repeat it. You can come close. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Warusulhu.
Warusulhu.
I bear witness.
I bear witness.
I bear witness.
I bear witness.
That there is no God but Allah.
There is no God but Allah.
And Prophet Muhammad.
And Prophet Muhammad.
Is the servant. Is the servant.
Is the servant.
And messenger of Allah.
And messenger of Allah.
MashaAllah. MashaAllah. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may He grant Jannah to our new Muslim, revert. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may He give this guidance to His other non-Muslim friends and His family members so that even they come to the straight path.